At this time, we're going to call this utility district meeting to order. Madam Clerk, roll call, please.
Chairperson Terrence Davis.
Here.
Chair Pro Tem Kashamba Miller Anderson.
Present.
Board Member Lynn Hubbard.
Present.
Board Member Tanya Davis Johnson.
Here.
Board Member Don Pardo.
Present.
Mayor Thomas A. Masters.
Finally present.
City Manager Ruth Jones.
Present.
Assistant Executive Director Giles Rhodes.
Here.
District Clerk Claudia Anthony is present. District Attorney Pamela Ryan.
Here.
District Finance Director Randy Sherman.
Here.
Thank you. We're going to stand for the moment of silence, and then the pledge will be led by Councilperson Johnson. Please face the north. Madam City Manager, do we have any additions, deletions, or substitution?
No additions to the agenda, but you did receive two items outside of your packet. One is a purchasing letter recommendation for item number 3 to the Hinterland Group, okay. And another purchasing recommendation letter for item number 4 with D.S. Eakins. And then additional to the item number 4 that you did not receive in your packet, there is backup information of minor changes made to the contract. Item number 1, which just specifies the end of the expiration of the contract, and item number 2, as it pertains to the contract. They're on a separate cover.
Okay, thank you. Do we have any disclosures by the board? Hearing none. We have a motion to adopt the agenda.
Second.
Motion and second. Madam Clerk.
Board Member Pardo.
Yes.
Board Member Davis Johnson.
Yes.
Board Member Hubbard.
Yes.
Pro Tem Miller Anderson.
Yes.
Chair Davis.
Yes.
Unanimous vote.
Thank you. All matters listed under this, no, go on the consent agenda, I apologize. All matters listed under this item are considered to be routine and action will be taken by one motion. There will be no separate discussion on these items unless a board member so requests, in which the event, the item will be removed from the general order of business and consider in its normal sequence or other agenda. Do we have any more items that need to be pulled before approving the consent agenda?
Yes.
Vice Chair?
3, 4, 6, and 10.
Three, four, six, and ten.
I was on a roll. You know me, right? 3, 4, and 6.
Anybody else have any other items that need to be removed? If you're not sure, we can pull it and we can go from there. Okay. We have a motion. Hold on. Councilperson Hubbard. So right now, 3, 4, 5, and 6. Yes, she does. Mayor, can you pass that microphone?
We share. Okay. The one also, sir.
So 1, 3, 4, 5, and 6. 215, correct?
1 and 5.
Okay. Do we have a motion to approve the consent agenda excluding 1, 3, 4, 5, and 6?
Move.
Do we have a second?
Second.
Madam Clerk.
Board Member Pardo.
Yes.
Board Member Hubbard.
Yes.
Board Member Davis Johnson.
Yes.
Pro Tem Miller Anderson.
Yes.
Chair Davis.
Yes.
Unanimous vote.
So now we're going to start for item number three.
Number one.
Number one, I'm sorry. Item number one.
A resolution of the Board of Directors of the City Riviera Beach Utility Special District, Palm Beach County, Florida, approving the contract with Aquifer Maintenance and Performance Systems, Inc. of West Palm Beach, Florida, allowing for payment of invoices for work previously completed by Aquifer Maintenance and Performance Systems, Inc., authorizing the chairperson and district clerk to execute said contract, authorizing the district finance director to pay an amount not to exceed $150,000 from account number 412-1437-5330-6405, and providing a revised effective date of December 15, 2015.
Second. Okay. Properly moved in second. Councilperson Hubbard, would you like a presentation on this?
Yes, I'd like to find out about the work that was previously approved prior to coming on this kind on this agenda.
All right. We previously brought this to a resolution to the board on June 20th. And approve the contract with AMPS to an effective date of April 15th, 2016. And it was requested by the board to ensure that everything was up to the work was not, no work proceeded before April 15th of 2016. Staff went back through the records and there was a contact made with AMPS and there was three outstanding invoices that were for work prior to that effective date, April 15th. The invoice totals for those invoices are for $20,452 prior to the previously approved effective date at the June 20th meeting.
So those three invoices, will they be covered under this $150,000? Are those included?
Yes, they will.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions, concerns about item number one? Madam Clerk.
Board Member Pardo?
Yes.
Board Member Hubbard?
Yes.
Board Member Davis Johnson?
Yes.
Pro Tem Miller Anderson?
Yes.
Chair Davis?
Yes.
Unanimous vote.
Thank you so much. Item number three.
A resolution of the Board of Directors of the City Riviera Beach Utility Special District, Palm Beach County, Florida, authorizing the Utility District Board to approve the contract with the Hinterland Group, Inc. of Riviera Beach, Florida, for sewer relining and inspection services to be performed as an in-kind project to the Florida Department of Environmental Protection under Consent Order OGC, file number 15-0459, authorizing the Utility District Board Chairperson and District Clerk to execute this contract and authorizing the District Finance Director to make payment in an amount not to exceed $64,850 from line item number 411-1417-5360-3106 and provide an effective date.
Do we have a motion?
So moved.
Second. Properly moved in second. Vice Chair,
Yes.
Miller,
I'll take a presentation, but I did have, I'm sorry, you're going to do it? Well, let me ask a question first. I see Mr. Giles is here, and this is along the lines of, I'm still within the question about this item. But I know, Ms. Jones, you said at our retreat date that Mr. Giles had put in his resignation. When is his date up?
I asked him if he would stay to the end of July.
To the end of July? Okay. Okay, go ahead and do that, and I'll come back to this.
Good evening. Good evening, Dean Mealy, Purchasing. The item bid 787-16 was sent out for issuance on 26th of May, and it closed on June 21st. These three bids were received by the city. Hinterland Group, Lonzo, and Backvision all bid. The bid package is inside your package. Hinterland was a low responsible bidder, and they bid $64,850 for the project that was outlined to be done.
Okay.
Okay, so I was just in.
May I add a little bit more information to that? This resolution is brought to you based on the consent order with the FDEP. It's going to be utilized for the in-kind penalty project that we applied for in lieu of the civil penalties. Hinterland Group is a firm that does cure-in-place lining and sewer mains, and essentially we selected a location that's a deep sewer main going to a lift station that is at or below groundwater table. And once the work is completed in there, the sewer mains will be at new condition again, and they will be rehabilitating manholes, removing any corrosive nature that they see, this scaling of the concrete and cracks, and bring them back to at new condition.
Okay. With the in the contract for them, on number 11, it noted that all notices required in this contract shall be sent to your attention. Does that cure the, I know we were talking before where the executive director received a lot of the information. Have we fixed that where someone else is brought into the loop as well in terms of receiving any notifications or any type of document so that we don't have the same problem we have when the other person is in your place?
Sure, notifications for this situation will be for questions from the contractor, maybe RFIs to the work, and deliverable of pay applications.
Okay, so that's what they're referring to with the notices.
Yes.
Okay.
Ms. Miller Anderson, just to clarify, number 11, when Mr. Rhodes does depart the city, addendum.
I can't really hear you.
When Mr. Rhodes leaves the city, I will, for item number 11, I will send out a notice to state.
Revise
where,
it. The name.
When documents are to be sent.
Okay, as well as number 33, well, it's right before number 34 on page 7.
Yes, ma'am. But I will address both items.
Okay. Okay, and then in regards to the consent order, I know this is an older one, but who else received a copy of this consent order? Ms. Jones, is it you?
This one was one that you all have received a copy of.
Okay, so but what I'm saying is from the city, you weren't copied on this. This is one of the ones that only Mr. Amajima had?
Yes.
Okay.
So that was the previous process.
Right.
Prior to the change.
Right. And let's see, looking at page 3 of the consent order, some of the issues that are in there, were they addressed? Have we corrected that? I don't know if this is for Mr. Baudet, Mr. Perry, Mr. Giles, like number 3B on page 3. About the water quality samples collected on the 9 days and
4B.
Huh? 4B. 4B on page 3.
If I may?
Okay,
These water quality samples were taken after a overflow of sanitary sewage, and they were collected at the point of discharge and into the location of the surface water that they entered into. They were collected, taken, and resampled until the samples came back in compliance with the standards for surface water for total coliforms or enterococcal.
Okay, so what that violation that is stated there, Rule 62-600.7402A, that has been corrected, so we will not see any issues of that nature in the future?
Right, the sample, the surface water has been returned back to normal.
Okay, and then for C, the utility sole method of the cleanup for May 19th. And it says the spill was to wash the wastewater into the nearby storm drains. That particular violation that's there, 62-604.130, has that part been corrected? So we won't have any of those violations again coming up?
Yes, ma'am. This is Bevan Bode. And we have, as part of the consent order, we have prepared a sanitary sewer overflow response plan.
I have questions about that, too.
Yes, and that plan has been submitted to the FDEP. And that includes training for our people, it includes new equipment, it includes the specific procedures on how to handle these types of overflows so that we will not be in violation in the future.
Okay. And then, glad that you mentioned that plan, because that's in here as well. Now, when the plan was submitted, was everything accepted and they don't have any issues with anything that's in there?
They reviewed it the first time and they gave us comments.
Okay.
The one that we submitted to them 2 weeks ago included their comments. Okay. However, the woman who at FDEP who is to review it, the final report, has been on vacation.
Okay.
So we haven't heard back from them. However, the initial response that we got from other staff people was that they were very pleased with it.
Okay. What about number two on page 27 of the sanitary sewer overflow response plan? It says appropriate system personnel would be notified. Who would that be?
I'm sorry, I'm lost.
Take a look at that.
Okay. You see it, number two on page 27? Mr. Davis is turning the gavel over to me. He's leaving the desk.
I got emergency.
Okay. Just so they know.
Appropriate personnel to be notified. I'll cover all of them. But the regulatory agencies that will be notified will be the FDEP, which will be our person to notify is Denise Watts, and they'd also have...
Okay.
The SED email that we attach with her, depending on the type of overflow that may exist, you may have to, based on details of it, submit a incident report to State Watch Office. And there's triggered requirements with that one.
Right.
If it goes into a surface water, you report. If it spills over 1,000 gallons, you report.
Okay.
As well as need to touch base with two personnel at the health department, Daryl Graziani and David Hubert.
Okay. And then on page 36, this is the last thing. On page 36, the overflow reporting, it says the utility supervisor will complete the required reports. Who would be that utility supervisor?
Will be Alan Davis, water and sewer superintendent.
Okay, that's it for me. Do we have any other questions for that item?
I wanted to ask one question, Madam Chair. I wanted to ask about when they give us the consent orders, being that they are legal documents for us to enter into with authorization, shouldn't we try to make sure that they're directed to the attorney's office? Because we can't legally enter, or has that been?
We have reached out to the special district where all of the notices have to be sent, or where they send notices from, and they have advised that there is only one name that they are going to have as the official name.
And which agency is that? Which one? I know we're dealing with three now, right?
What was it?
We got DEP.
This was the division that regulates special districts. What they do is they don't know any individuals, so they go to the website to get the names of the persons to whom to send their notices. And so that's what all of these entities did. What we have asked the local health department to do is to add the legal department to the name, because we tried to add it on the website and they will not let us add it on the website. So all you can do is to ask. I guess we could send a letter directly to DEP and ask them to copy us, but that doesn't ensure that they will. But the official address that they're going to send notifications to is the name that's listed on the statewide website.
Okay, so, but I guess staff and our city is real clear that when something comes like that, we need to get it to legal as fast as we can by carrier pigeon or whatever, because we cannot, you know, they might not know where to find the right spot, but we know where it needs to be before we go. So, and just a little further, they, for them to give us these consents, not directed to legal, but then to include that they have contact with legal, how are they able to do that?
I don't know what contact you're talking about.
Like, okay, like one of the letters, one of the documents had you and Ms. Jones in it, and that was like 2014 or something, September 2014, but then they aren't sending the stuff to you, but they named you.
They did not. They sent it was an anomaly. They have not been able to explain it. They sent it to Judy Davis, and it came to my office because they sent it to the board chairperson instead of to Lou. Was it Lou at the time? Whoever it was. That was the only time that they sent something directly to my office. And it was in care of, it was sent to Judy Davis in care of the city attorney's office.
Okay. Okay. And it must be an anomaly because we need like the pre-conference hearing and there was a notice. And that's a legal ask, you know, something legal that if we get to that point and our attorney is not being contacted, I hope I can find that one that they had put your name and Mrs. Jones' name on it, stating that they had contacted.
That may have been the one from September 2014 that I have referred to. Yes.
September of 2014, I believe it was.
And we were involved in that process at that
point. In September?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
That's it?
Yes, that's it.
Okay. Any other questions?
Board Member Pardo?
Yes.
Board Member Davis Johnson?
Yes.
Board Member Hubbard?
Yes.
Pro Tem Miller Anderson.
Yes.
That motion is approved with Chair Davis out.
Okay, we're moving to item number 4.
A resolution of the Board of Directors of the City of Riviera Beach Utility Special District, Palm Beach County, Florida, approving the contract with D.S. Eakins Construction Corp. of Lake Park, Florida, piggybacking contract number 110783C with Palm Beach County for crews with equipment and rental of equipment to provide underground on-call services, authorizing the utility district chairperson and district clerk to execute this contract, authorizing the finance director to make payment from the contract services sewer account line item number 411-1438-5350-3405 at a cost not to exceed $100,000 annually, and providing an effective date of December 15th, 2015.
So moved.
Do we have a
second?
Okay. Do we have a discussion? Well, I wanted a presentation.
Second,
I think
yeah,
I'm
second
it,
for
so.
Discussion.
Well, he's going to do the presentation because that was the one that I pulled, so let him do the presentation first.
Okay.
Good evening, Council. Dean Neely, purchasing. The emergency contract was a contract that had been requested prior to Mr. Arjemi leaving and never got pushed forward. Can you hear?
I can't really.
Can I hear?
That's
better now.
Can
you hear me better now?
Yeah.
Okay. The item had been tabled for a short time pending Mr. Arjemi pushing it forward to my office, and this is finally making the council meeting. The goal here was to do a piggyback against Palm Beach County in the short term, but to actually go out and do our own solicitation within the next, in the letter I gave you right before the meeting this evening, within the next 45 days. I actually want to move that time frame up since Mr. Rhodes is leaving at the end of July, to work with him between now and the end of July to actually put a scope of services together that I can put on the street by August 1st. so we'd actually get our own contract put together. The bids come back in by the fourth week of August, do an evaluation, and actually bring it back to council first meeting in September.
So what is the number one?
Pardon?
The amendment that was made to the attachment that we were given a few minutes ago?
The attachment, I only give you a letter of recommendation to move forward that the contract, there is an existing contract. Mm-hmm. Eakins is willing to provide the exact same pricing that Palm Beach County is currently getting. So that is, from the purchasing standpoint, they've met the threshold for actual doing a piggyback. But I also wanted to add into there that we want to go out and do our own solicitation for this.
Right, okay.
Which would be in the best interest of the city.
But the part that's in the box for number one, it says which will expire on, you're basically saying it's going to expire at the end of August because you want to have this in place, do everything you need to do by
yes,
the beginning of September.
Yes, ma'am.
And that was the only thing
yes,
that
ma'am.
Was added on the new sheet here?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Any other questions? Huh? And then number 33, as it pertains to the contract, just added and inserted a couple words there. On page 6, number 33, the independent contractor shall comply with Florida's Public Records Act, Chapter 119, Florida statutes, as it pertains to this contract. That was just a clerical error or something, or what?
She's on page 7, which would be item number
page
6.
I have, it's on the page 6 of the standard materials and services agreement with D.S. Eakins.
Okay, so this is your, I'm sorry, this is you here? Who am
this,
I?
This is probably, should be directed to me because
okay,
it's from
whoever
me.
Okay, whoever can give me an answer, go ahead.
Yes, sorry for jumping in there. Contractor asked for additional text to be added to the contract, and what the independent contractor asked for is related to Chapter 119. He just requested that the language be as it pertains to this contract because it's for public records requests.
Okay. All right, any other questions?
Also, Councilperson Anderson?
Yes.
On item number 33, as it was in the last item, when we discussed number 3, subparagraph D, where it references Mr. Rhodes in the item, I will also make an addendum to Ms. Rhodes' last day to have the wording changed.
The name, okay.
Okay.
All right, sounds good. Any other questions from the board? None?
Board Member Pardo? Board Member Davis Johnson?
Yes.
Board Member Hubbard?
Yes.
Chair Miller Anderson?
Yes.
That motion is approved with Chair Davis out.
Okay, moving to item number 5.
A resolution of the Board of Directors of the City of Riviera Beach Utility Special District, Palm Beach County, Florida, approving work authorization number 20A for C Solutions, Inc. in the amount not to exceed $38,100 for engineering services associated with the rehabilitation, replacement of lift stations number 10 and number 50, and authorizing the district finance director to pay this amount from account number 411-1417-5360-3106 and provide an effective date.
All right, that item was pulled by Ms. Hubbard. You want a presentation?
Yes, I would like, please, thank you.
Yes, I'll refer to this project as construction testing services in relation to the lift station rehabilitation and reconstruction projects that are currently ongoing. The resolution is brought to the board for recommendation and approval as an amendment to current work authorization for construction testing services. This is a not to exceed cost for the owner to provide services for testing of soils and materials such as concrete, asphalt, and compression testing at the new lift station sites. This was previous work authorization that were prepared by the owner, and a work authorization for $18,000 was developed for this construction testing services. I would say the original budget was under budgeted for this, as well as there were some circumstances in the field that went through the budget quickly with failure of tests, and we're in the process of reviewing that. But this new work authorization amendment, I personally vetted through with the contractor and the geotechnical firm to ensure that we had a conservative cost here to complete the rest of the work on the lift station projects. And this is for work authorization of $38,100.
Okay. Ms. Hubbard?
Okay, and that's what I was not seeing in here, that it was an amendment. And I thought 38,000 was kind of low compared to the, I guess, other rehabs of the other lift stations, but I didn't notice. But I see what you, I see he's made it clear that this is an amendment.
Right. Yes, it is.
Okay.
Yes, it is. 38,000.
Because it was low-balled. Okay. Okay, thank you.
Okay, are there any other questions from the board? Okay.
Madam Chair, I want to make clear for the record about the motion. The motion was made by Board Member Davis Johnson.
Yes.
And seconded by Board Member Pardo. Okay. Just wanted to make sure because it wasn't done in the microphone so the transcriptionist can know. Board Member Pardo?
Yes.
Board Member Davis Johnson?
Yes.
Board Member Hubbard?
Yes.
Chair Miller Anderson?
Chair. Yes. Yes.
That motion is approved with Chair Davis out.
Okay. Okay, we're at number item 6.
A resolution of the Board of Directors of the City of Riviera Beach Utility Special District, Palm Beach County, Florida, approving the First Amendment to the Marina Uplands Funding Interlocal Agreement between the City of Riviera Beach and the City of Riviera Beach Utility Special District and the City of Riviera Beach Redevelopment Agency by increasing the maximum amount paid to the agency to $12,641,539 and authorizing the chairperson and district clerk to execute same and provide an effective date.
So moved.
Second.
Okay. Good evening, Randy Sherman, District Finance Director. Yeah, this is the first amendment to the Marina Uplands Funding Interlocal Agreement. In 2014, the utility district, the city, and the CRA signed this agreement to provide funding from the city and the district towards the marina project. During last year's budget process, the CRA had identified this $738,000 of unfunded items that they came to the city and asked that the city assist in. $599,000 is for what we'll call site amenities, such as tree grates, ballasts, benches, and the other $138,000 is for Avenue C. So again, the city and CRA have already approved this agreement. We actually approved it last November. This is actually, because it's again tri-party, this is the district's approval.
Okay, I think, yeah, I was absent, so I guess that's why it seems fresh on my mind on when that happened in November. So this is something we've already done. I saw that in there as well,
yes.
But I know that I wasn't.
And we talked about this 2 weeks ago at the retreat.
I just wanted to make sure that was exactly what we were discussing, mm-hmm. Something that I'd seen and I mean heard from when we talked before. Okay, that's okay. It. Go ahead. We're ready. Any other questions or not? Okay.
Board Member Pardo?
Yes.
Board Member Hubbard?
Yes.
Board Member Davis Johnson?
Yes.
Chair Miller Anderson?
Yes.
Unanimous vote.
Okay. That's the end of our consent agenda. No awards and presentations?
None.
Public hearings?
None.
Okay, we're going to our regular agenda, item number 9.
A resolution of the Board of Directors of the City of Riviera Beach Utility Special District, Palm Beach County, Florida, authorizing the district to negotiate rates in an agreement with U.S. Water Services Corporation to assess, analyze, and complete a corrective action report as directed in Consent Order WP-02016 and provide an effective date.
So moved.
Do we have a second?
Second.
Okay.
Dean Neely, Purchasing, good evening, Council. The RFP was issued on May 26th and closed on June 21st. was RFP 803-16. There's only one firm that submitted a package to the city for this particular RFP. And they are here tonight to present for if they had questions.
That's it.
The selection committee has met, and they have recommended the firm.
Which committee?
The selection committee.
Oh. Okay. Any questions from
I'm
the board?
I'm going to refer to Giles, Mr. Rhodes, on this one as well.
Go ahead.
Okay. What we have brought toward before you is an authorization to negotiate with this firm that provided a proposal package in associated with the Palm Beach County Health Department consent order WP-020-16 to do a condition assessment of the water treatment plant, as well as some operational assessments in the system and review of distribution testing and analysis from licensed distribution personnel. Provider of the package has worked on jobs in similar scope of services for utilities of similar size or larger in the area. We asked to move forward and negotiate rates and services with this firm to provide this condition assessment report and provide this list of personnel to the health department prior to the due date of July 21st.
Are there any questions from the board?
And this is to suffice for one of our, this is to suffice for one of our in-kind projects that this they're allowing us to do?
This is not an in-kind penalty project, no. This is a requirement inside the consent order itself that the respondent needs to provide.
And we are the respondent?
Yes.
That we need to provide.
Going back to the previous council meeting, the utility district council meeting 2 months ago, when the direction was given for me to go out and do a new solicitation, that's we fast-tracked it. We did it. We put it out the following week, and we actually put it in with 21 days. So we were very time-sensitive, and we tried to expedite the package so we can meet the time frame of the order as well.
Madam Chair.
Go ahead.
Did you name some of the other cities that they have done work for? Some of the other districts.
Really. I'm going to refer to the vendor themselves so they can speak.
That's fine. Come on up, sir. Come on down.
Good afternoon. Good evening. For the record, my name is Gary Dermer. I'm the president of U.S. Water. To answer Mayor Thomas's question, the scope of work that is proposed, which is included in your consent order, is very similar to other local cities that we've worked for, including the city of South Bay, the city of West Palm Beach. We've done work, although not in a consent order, but to resolve many water quality issues throughout Florida, in Golden Gate, Lehigh Acres, Pasco County, the city of North Lauderdale, the city of Lauder Hill. So we're very familiar with, you know, the process of water treatment and the process of troubleshooting systems and doing assessments. And I can tell you that, you know, assessments take you in all different directions. Our company is an engineering company, we're a contracting company, we're an operations company. So we're well versed in trying to sort things out as far as which direction it might take you. We don't have any kind of preconceived notion of where it might take us, but I'm quite sure that we can help the city provide reliable and safe drinking water, which I believe is everybody's goal here. There was a question about staffing to the project. I have a relationship with many of the people at the health department, initially in the West Palm Beach situation where they had an outbreak of coliform bacteria. You know, I had committed to them that I would head up that project because of the nature of that project. I've also committed to the health department in this case that I would be the person on the ground for your utility. I have a home in Wellington, so I would, I actually live on the other coast, but I would come over for that period of 60 to 70 days and, you know, be the lead person on the project, as well as other folks that have worked with me for many years that I would rely on for support.
You seem to have a great reputation with the Palm Beach County Health Department.
We do. We're very proud of our reputation with the health department there, as well as the DEP throughout the state. If there's a tough problem that, you know, has been out there for water, wastewater treatment, a lot of those things kind of find their ways to us. So, you know, like I say, we're prepared to help the city any way we can.
Have you done any work out of the state of Florida?
We do. We have a relatively large project we're working on right now for the city of San Antonio. We have work in Austin, Dallas. We have a large 20 MGD system we're starting right now in Iowa, Nebraska, Oklahoma. We started our first system there.
So would you say you're the best out there, wouldn't you?
I like to think we're the best. We're not, you know, I have to tell you, we're a firm of, you know, 450 to 500 people. So we're not the largest. We're the largest in Florida, but we're not the largest. Some of our competing firms are international firms with, you know, sales of excess of $1 billion a year. But I've been in Florida since I've been 5 years old, and this is all I've ever done in my professional career. So we're going to give you guys some good advice.
One final question. Were you contacted at all about the Flint situation?
Flint situation.
Flint, Michigan.
Oh, Flint situation. Well, a friend of mine, Lois Frankel, who you guys know probably,
yeah.
Sent a few emails out, but I think they got that situation figured out very quickly.
Okay.
But we thought about it, but we didn't go that far.
You were standby. We were thinking.
Yeah, I mean, that's
okay.
Right.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Are there any other questions from the board? I did have a question. This, and it may not be necessarily for you, is Ms. Jones or Mr. Rhodes. This is similar to bringing us into compliance, or similar to what Mr. Bode is doing? Are we replacing Mr. Bode, or how does that company figure in with what we already have going on?
The scope of how broad the study is different. Mr. Baudet is here helping us as we do day-to-day those things to troubleshoot, to make sure the purchasing, procurement, that we can do the consent orders and all of that, kind of the administrative.
Okay.
What this company do, they will look at your systems, they will look at your pipes, they'll look at your processes, they'll look at everything and make a recommendation based on what they find.
Was this company very similar to when we discussed BFA?
Could have been,
but they did
but
not
they
apply.
Elected not to
they didn't
submit anything.
Submit a bid, okay.
Yes, same area.
Okay, are there any other questions? All right.
Board Member Pardo?
Yes.
Board Member Hubbard?
Yes.
Board Member Davis Johnson?
Yes.
Chair Miller Anderson?
Yes.
Unanimous vote.
Okay, that's the end of our regular agenda. Do we have any public comment cards? Because I don't have any.
Number 10.
Madam Chair, we have one more item. Number 10.
You scratched it out.
Oh. See, y'all told me to take it all the way off. I'm sorry. Okay, 10 is back on my agenda now. All right, I'm sorry. Number 10.
A resolution of the Board of Directors of the City of Riviera Beach Utility Special District, Palm Beach County, Florida, authorizing the district to approve amendment number 2 to the contract between the Utility Special District and C Solutions, Inc. to provide continuing professional engineering services for lift stations number 10 and number 50, not to exceed the amount of $207,243, and this amount, and authorizing the district finance director to pay this amount from account number 411-1417-5360-3106, and authorizing the utility district board chairperson and district clerk to execute amendment number 2 and provide an effective date.
So moved.
Second.
Okay. You have a question? Yes.
In item number 5 and in item number 10,
tell me the difference.
Well, can we get the presentation first for?
Okay.
Can we?
That's what I wanted him to present.
Okay,
to include, in his presentation, whatever that might be. But I'm looking to hopefully to hear from the presentation. Is the differences in the similarity and what's happening with number 5 and number 10? One's 38,000 and one's 220 something.
Yes, ma'am. What you have in this resolution is we are bringing a recommendation for approval of extending construction administrative services for the lift station construction project. What you had in resolution 5 were for construction testing services that are done by a geotechnical firm. The construction testing would, they take density tests of compacted fill under, say, roadways or trench work that has been refilled and taken density tests as concrete that gets poured for building foundations and building walls, slabs, and things like that. That's what resolution number 5 was about. What you have here in resolution number 10 is to proceed with extending construction administrative services for a consultant, Sea Solutions, is providing them. They provide various tasks in this contract. Some of the most important ones are general management, project meeting coordination, project meeting representation and recording of project meetings, contract interpretation, shop drawing reviews, contract document question reviews, interpretation, pay app review, change order proposal processing, and discipline specific inspections that would be outside of the building department's inspections to ensure conformance with contract documents, as well as an on-site project representative to document construction representation for the owner, the utility, or the city themselves.
Question. So Sea Solutions is a company that does density testing, they do the construction, and they can do the administration as well. Is this based on what you just read?
I'm glad you asked that because I didn't clarify in item number 5. Sea Solutions has a project team of various consulting firms. Under that team, there's a Radis International that are in the city of Riviera Beach that are a geotechnical firm that are part of their project team. So they are essentially a pass-through through Sea Solutions to do the construction testing, Radis. But Sea Solutions and Hazen and Sawyer provide the construction administrative services.
Okay, now let's talk about what's happening with 10.
Okay, a lift station 10 is...
No, Sea Solutions role and which one of the project team members are performing these services, and again, which services are they? Because couple of things, like in 5, you said that Deeks is actually going to do the work, C is a pass-through, so what's happening in 10?
10 will be, Sea Solutions will be the project manager of the construction and administrative services, with team members handling specifics, inspection services, as well as assisting in construction administrative services and project management and relevant shop drawing review.
Okay, and how long is this contract supposed to be for?
The contract for this project is simultaneously goes on with the lift station construction project. It extends out a little beyond because there's operational training following substantial and final completion of this project by the construction contractor.
Is Sea Solutions the contractor that beat out BFA in the beginning?
We were part of a separate solicitation. I do not recall if BFA was on the RFQ on that selection. I do not recall them.
You don't think they were on it at all?
I do not believe so. I do not believe so.
Are there any other questions?
Yes, Madam Chair.
You finished, Ms. Hubbard?
I am. Thank you, sir.
Go ahead.
Madam Chair. You don't recall?
I do not recall. The BFA may have had a contract at the time. I do not recall. This was this contract was approved. I'm sorry. Let me take this back. This was an RFP simply for to design and construction services of the lift station. This is not part of the continuing services contract. So the consultant won this RFP in the CCNA process to design, and then further we amended that contract for construction administration services as well as certification of the project at final completion.
So the answer is that they were not, BFA was not in this?
I do not know. This was before I started here.
Okay. Okay, I'd like to get that information whenever you can.
Okay.
By the next meeting. Also, the company, have you, in your due diligence and research, can you tell me a little bit about the company? The construction, the consultant?
The consultant's in the crowd. If I could ask him to come up and tell you a little bit about his skills and his experience.
Sure.
Yeah, I like to know.
Hi, Mayor.
Hi, how are you?
Pretty good. We essentially are an engineering consulting firm, and on our team we have other members, Hazen and Sawyer, and this is all we do. We do water and wastewater treatment on many treatment plants for other municipalities, Miami-Dade County, Broward County, Palm Beach County. I think we've just done master plans. Sea Solutions been on the master plans, water and wastewater for Riviera Beach. We were a sub to Hazen and Sawyer at that time. We've done the master plan for the Glades as part of a team there. Palm Beach County, we're part of a Camp Dresser McKee's team for Broward County. And we've done a lot of pump stations across the state. I've been here locally for 20 years, and I think the first inline booster I did was City of Sunrise, 1996. Our team's done over large wastewater pump stations. We probably have over 90 of them, considering this project is just one of them. We specialize in doing treatment plants and big pump station systems.
How many employees do you have coming?
Sea Solutions has four.
Four. How diverse is that four?
High diverse.
Diverse. You have minorities of the four, or just what?
Personally, I am a.
I thought you looked a little darker.
Yeah. Personally, I am. My dad's English.
Might have been
English.
The light in the room.
Yeah. My dad's English and my mom is Jamaican, so we are a statewide certified MBE firm, African American firm, and we are also federally certified as a DBE firm. And have been since 2007.
Okay, thank you.
But on the diversity of our employees, the person here, we do have diversity in our team, plus we have experience, and I think that's what really counts. Two of our employees have 48 years of experience, and one was the former lead design engineer for CDM for the entire Southeast United States. So this is essentially what we do. This is always what we've done, and we continue to do it, hopefully, well for you.
Question, Madam Chair?
Yes, go ahead.
The skill, quality, and qualification is definitely high on the list of priorities, and it's definitely what matters. But you have an array, I guess, of team members or subs that you work with, because we know all four of y'all can't do all of this work. So what are some of the companies that you team with?
Well, Hazen & Sawyer is a recognized national firm, does international work. We also do some international work. I think the latest was a 12 million MGD plant for the country of Panama. Hazen and Sawyer is a large engineering firm. They're working with Miami-Dade on a lot of their projects, also on one of the largest consent decree projects in the entire nation for the city of New York City. They're their consultant.
With that said, do you have many other minorities other than yourself that you try to outreach, work with, or whatever, or because you meet the standard for the MBE or the SBE, that's enough?
Well, in our company, I mean, two of the guys I mentioned are three are contracts. So if I said four, we really have a couple more because I have a contract inspector and the two gentlemen that I had told you about. But three of, if you're including me, three of our employees, my CAD tech, Todd Morgan, that many of you might have met, and also our latest junior, are African American, if that's the question.
That's the question.
Okay.
No problem. Hey, that's the question. Let's be real about it, because, and not just with that. So, coming to do a project here in Riviera Beach, you may find yourself in need of services. So, your Hazel and your partner Sawyer,
Correct. That you work with.
I want to know that, or trying to find out from you, when you start to look for other help, are you looking here in Riviera Beach first? For example, I know you got to need backhoe digging and stuff like that, earth moving and...
We're an engineering firm, an engineering mm-hmm. consulting firm. We do no construction.
None.
So we do none, and our team members that we set, just to be clear, we have two contracts actually.
Okay.
We have the 10 and 50 that was awarded, and it was advertised as a single contract.
Okay.
Which we pursued and won. We also have a general consulting services contract, and you typically have two of those, and you're about to refill. I think there's an advertisement out that'll probably be coming in to bid soon, which will have the second general consulting engineer that the city of Riviera Beach can use as they would like. For instance, Mr. Rhodes brought up agenda item 5. Under the existing contract, the owner, which is you, is required to hire their own independent, testing company to look over. We serve as an owner's rep. The Riviera Beach Utility District asked us, because we have an existing contract and they needed that, to use the services, right, of RADICE to do that. That's as like a work authorization under a general services amendment. So you can have many of those for your general contractor.
Gotcha.
What we're speaking of here is for lift station 10 and 50, which is a separate contract from the general services contract. On that contract, we are providing services to look at the work of the contractor that was selected. And why we're here is to make sure that they give you what you need to have, to make sure that they provide the quality construction services they need to provide. We provide specifications for them to follow. We're making sure they adhere to those so that when you get a project and you get the completion of that project, you know it's going to work and that wastewater east of I-95 will be pumped to ECR.
So you designed the project.
I did design it.
And then you make sure that the construction team constructed the way that you designed it and that it operates the way that you intended for it to flow.
That's your perfect summary.
Okay.
That's exactly what we're doing.
That's your purpose. Okay. How much is the construction on this project?
It's $3.8 million.
Hush. This might not be a question for you. Who's building this $3.8 million? Apparently not me.
Close construction.
Hmm?
Close construction.
That's the name of the company?
That's the
CLOSE.
Yeah, that is the contractor that was selected. So they're the ones with the backhoe and earth
moving. Close construction.
Close construction, yes.
And they've been, Chair, if I may.
Yes.
One of the reasons that we're bringing this amendment to you is because of the extra work that this company is having to do because of issues that we're having with close construction. I wanted to wait till this was done to, just for a minute, to discuss this, but staff has been meeting about close construction in the last few weeks, and in attempting to draft a memo that Ms. Pardo asked for on the, as an update, we met and have determined that there are a lot of issues, including their request for a 180-day change order. I think the whole project was supposed to take
1 year.
365, right. And so they're asking for a 50% increase. And I would say that if I were going to be here and I expressed this to them, I would become more involved because I think that this case is going to end up in litigation. But I have spoken with attorney Malcolm Cunningham, who does a great deal of construction litigation. I believe that staff, if the board will allow staff to retain him to at least start looking at the issues, because I believe that eventually, if we can't get them in line, and I'm not sure that we can at this point, that we may be filing a lawsuit against close construction. And we're definitely going to write a letter to their surety company to put them on notice that they are falling way behind on this construction project.
So, sir, so what's the problem? So what have you found their problem to be? Is it neither one?
I mean, what are the problems? And we can discuss some of the problems, some of the things. I've read the memo, and I'm tweaking the memo because,
come on,
I want to make it attorney-client privilege in anticipation of litigation, but generally they can tell you what some of the issues. Please go ahead.
Let me ask this. I just want to, just for a point of clarification. The plan and design that C Solutions did, they didn't perform it well. They didn't build it out right, and it's having some problems. No. And I'm not saying that either.
Right. You're just saying they designed the project. We took the project, put it out to bid, close construction.
It was supposed to be building.
It was a straight bid.
Yes.
They were the low bidder by about $40,000. And so we awarded the project
to them. Right.
They got on the project and quickly, I guess, I shouldn't say quickly, but they're behind change orders, which has made.
You have to go and bring him back to see where the mistakes are and what's causing them all of these
and to document them. And to document them. Right, Ms. Herbert, I just would like to say that I have been in this business for 49 years as a public official and an administrator of a utility agency. This is one of the worst performing contractors that I have been involved with in that 49 years. They're asking for 6 months additional time to finish the job. They've already asked for $160,000 in change orders. They haven't documented their requests. But for us to prevail and to keep from being taken to the cleaners by this company, we need to document what's going on. And that's what we're asking C Solutions to do by giving them this authorization.
And I understand that, and I get that, nor was that my point when I was in exchange with Ms. Ryan, and what I was just trying to confirm and to clarify that the reason he's here, because we're trying to see what it is that they're doing wrong. Where did they make these mistakes? Who better than he, since he designed it, to see what they should have did that they didn't do that's causing them to have to ask for all of these things? And that's what I was trying to find out, if that's what's going on. Second question to that is this. When we looked at the work that they've done previously, their resume, their history, the people that they worked for, did they come back clean? Did all their other past
jobs that people say that they didn't have any problems with them, that they their insurance company, have they been, you know, sued on that before? Did we take them just because they were the low bidder?
They were taken on low qualified bidder. Four references were requested to be submitted in the package, and purchasing put out the questionnaire to the municipalities that were listed on the reference sheet, and returned responses that were in the lines of excellent to good, and purchasing made the recommendation based on those reference letters coming back from municipalities to proceed forward as a qualified contractor.
When you say excellent to good, the type of work that they did for these municipalities, is it the same type of work that we're asking them to do here at this time, or was it something less complicated that they got excellent to good on?
There were portions in there that were similar in scope, and I would say one of three was similar in scope to a portion of this project. They didn't have a similar scope project to an inline booster station, and that wasn't.
They were similar in scope to one of the projects and not even the complete project. So I say that to say this. They seem like they didn't have the experience to do the job because they were just a low bidder, but they didn't seem like they had the experience to do the job. And I'm just getting this from what, you know, from the questions I'm asking and what you're telling me, because out of the four that responded and said they were excellent to good, they only had partial experience in that one job. So they weren't ready for this job. That's why they're messing up. So we've got to do a better job of checking in the back, you know, their backgrounds, the type of work, putting apples with apples and oranges with oranges. And sometimes just because the guy is the lowest bidder doesn't mean anything. It means he wants the job. Doesn't mean he the best for the job. So he can always bid low and then come back and ask you for change orders and amendments, and still now he costing you a whole lot more money. So I just wanted to point that out to you.
Madam Chair.
Go ahead.
I need to know who had the fiduciary duty to do the due diligence to investigate this company. Was it purchasing or was it utilities?
Purchasing resources follows up with the references on that. But as far as I'm concerned, the utilities do have a role to review the references themselves. At the time of the references, I did raise caution on the scope of services to the former director, and purchasing did come back with a recommendation based on the references, and we proceeded at that time.
So purchasing, one, you signed off on the two, is what you're saying?
It was signed off by the utility, yes.
Thank you, sir.
Who sat on the selection committee, sir?
Finish, Mr. Mayor, you're done?
Yes. Who sat on our selection committee?
There was not a selection committee in it. The package is reviewed for compliance with the request in the bid.
Okay, so once the bids were open and reviewed, who reviewed them?
That's the package itself is initially bid reviewed through purchasing department.
So you may or may not know the answer to this. So in purchasing, who reviewed the package?
Subordinating Dean Mealy. This happened before I began.
Okay.
And I had to go back and look at the records to see how it would have actually unfolded. But generally, a cursory, for technical review, purchasing responsibilities to make sure that each part of the sections have been addressed. At that point, then it is sent to the user division or department
to have them, their technical expertise, review what the qualifications are as to what particular line items are being bid on. And that's where the cooperation and the coexistence would actually agree to say, hey, this is what we bid on, this is what we requested, and the vendor can either complete or there's a question of whether they can do it or not.
Okay. So if we didn't or don't have, okay, let's say even if we do have the expertise or should have the expertise within the utility district and you have a engineering firm consultant on call or something like that, wouldn't you then have them open the bid packages with you, look at the level of work, compare it to what you're asking, see if these guys are ready for this kind of job? You would bring them to the table on the front end when you open in the packages to say, hey, I don't think this guy is going to be able to do this work, or yeah, these guys will be perfect for this work, throw this one out, you know. You see what I'm saying?
Yes, I do.
So this is what I'm thinking, just would be just a common order of business. If we want to protect ourselves, or if we want to make sure that if we don't have I'm not saying the skill sets, but if we could do lift stations, we'd be doing them ourselves. So we have outside people doing them. So we need that kind of level of expertise at the table when we're going to choose somebody for those jobs on the front end, not after the fact. I think we would do I think we should put together a selection team where you can have one checking the money, one checking the skill set. Somebody's looking at for technical services. Somebody's saying, hey, this guy, I heard at the last engineer meeting, don't hire him. And you know, and so that you can get some feedback, because when the only voice you hear is your own and you're just relying on your own experience, then I think that's how we will end up in places like we are now.
Madam Chair,
yes.
Just briefly.
You've heard the discussion tonight. You've heard, correct? You've been paying attention.
Yes, sir.
What do you think we need to do differently going forward? What have we learned from this process? Madam Chair, Manager, would you like to come?
Can I answer that?
You can.
One of the things that has become very apparent as I've been meeting with Mr. Mealy and with Mr. Rhodes, and that is the volume of the procurements that come out of utilities is really taxing for the purchasing department. The purchasing department has, five people, and they do the purchasing for the entire city and back up the CRA. It is important that we establish in the utilities department an individual that can do those exact reference checks you're talking about, that know enough about the profession as well as about the vendors to be able to assist purchasing. Because we can't ask purchasing to do that kind of in-depth. And if the other individuals aren't aware of the companies, so you're going to see in the budget coming up a procurement position strictly for utilities, because these things have to move, they've got to be on them, and people reading them need to make sure that they're reading them correctly.
Thank you. In all experiences, we always want to grow, go and glow and learn, then we won't make the same mistakes again. Thank you, Madam Manager.
Okay. One more comment, Madam Chair. Even with that said, I would not expect purchasing to be the technical knowledge bearer of this. What I would have expected would be the utility department to have enough, one, technical experience to know what they don't know, and two, enough of relationships and skill sets to look at it a lot better than purchasing and saying, if purchasing say, hey, this guy's a low bidder, then and it gets over to utility and utility, somebody at utility should be able to say, he might be the low bidder, but he don't have experience for this job. And then they kick it back to purchasing and say, who's your next guy? He was a little higher than the one we just kicked out, but he's a lot better. We'd rather work with him because he has more experience. Somebody in utility need to have that level of experience now, not because we're bringing in a procurement person, but I still state that if you are in, you're the engineer and you're heading up this department, you got to at least be able to look at somebody's resume and say, are they capable of doing what you want them to do, just on the surface. And then that's when you're going to bring your other guy in to say, look, to look at it too, to say, this is what I think. And he might say, yeah, he all right, and he might even kick it out. But I'm just saying, we have the right to expect at least that skill set inside in-house.
Okay, any other questions from the board?
Will this position that you're talking about, be advertised?
It will be advertised, but we are going to be looking for, if we can, that specialty as it relates to utilities. May not have it, but then we'll go to a general procurement person.
So are we, in instances where there are large procurements such as these, do we have to necessarily do it as an invitation for bid? Can we put it out as a request for proposals to, because I know that there are different requirements for different solicitations. So, you know, when we're doing the bid is strictly based on price. Right.
On construction services or design services, like construction typically comes back as a request for proposal from a qualified contractor.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas maybe design services through the CCNA would be a request for qualifications in the right to negotiate rates.
And Close came under a request for qualifications?
No, they were under an RFP. Close was. Close Construction is a contractor building the lift station.
It's not RFP. It's a bid. It's
bid.
Not
RFP. RFP.
Bid. Invitation for bid.
Invitation for bid.
It was an invitation for
but
bid.
But
it could have been an RFP.
I think that's something that we also need to take a look at as to how we are soliciting. Because certain solicitation gives you the flexibility to look at overall experience, scope of work, references, whereas a bid just simply says you look at the lowest bid and that's where you go. So I would suggest, in addition to having that extra set of eyes, that we really take a look at how we are letting those solicitations,
yep,
to allow us the flexibility to maneuver and to get to where we need to get to as it relates to identifying the best company to perform.
And I do agree.
Thank you.
Ms. Johnson, just to state, in the 10 months I've been here, I think we've only put out 3 ITBs. The rest of them have all been RFPs. I've been trying to increase the number of RFPs so we can actually figure out what kind of qualifications are actually sitting out there as compared to just straight bid where you have a lot of unknown variables. Unless you're, ITBs are great for commodities, not for services.
Absolutely.
That's been my experience over the last 40 years or so.
Any other questions from the
board?
No. Ms. Pardo?
No. All right. Board Member
Pardo? Yes.
Board Member Davis Johnson?
Yes.
Board Member Hubbard?
Yes.
Chairman Lee Anderson?
Yes.
Unanimous vote.
Okay, now we're at the end.
Any consideration to allowing staff to hire Mr. Cunningham on a consultation basis? While staff is looking at whether or not litigation should be had with Close Construction. And we would expend funds within the manager's authority at this level, because staff may have to come back and ask for a lawsuit to be filed against Close Construction.
Hold on 1 minute. Are we good in this section here, or is this something we need to come back at the end?
About.
With our
comments. Well, I was only bringing it up because it was related to the item.
Even though we know where to vote and everything. All right. Anybody have any comments about that?
Yes, please.
Yeah. No problem.
The reason I have a question is because don't we want to wait until the gentleman do his analysis and survey and see what the problem is, so when you go to the attorney, you'll be able to tell him what the problem is, or no?
Well, we've been meeting, I and Ms. Busby, we've been meeting with staff quite a bit, and every time they say, okay, we think we got it, we think we have them on task, they come back a week later and say, we don't think we have them on task. They say they're gonna do X, Y, and Z, they haven't done it.
I must be confused. I must be totally confused. Help me out before we leave. My thinking is this, and I'm sure I must be off. Now, we're bringing in this gentleman because we're having a little problem with the construction company. He's gonna analyze the situation, take a look at the situation, see what's going wrong, see where the problems is, and then tell us what he think we should do. He may tell us that, hey, these guys just don't have it. The only way y'all gonna be able to recoup your money is to get yourself an attorney. And then at that point, then we get ourselves an attorney. Because we don't know what to tell the attorney that people have done and what the problem. We can say they're doing a bad job, they slack, they got problems, they late, they want 180 days. But then what is he gonna do after the fact? If we go into litigation and then we tell him to take a look at the problem? But don't we want him to take a look at the problem before we go into litigation?
I'd like to answer that, Ms. Hubbard. When you begin to have problems with a contractor, that is the time to bring in expert legal counsel, because you have a lot of options ahead of you. What you really would hope not to do is to get into litigation. You have the opportunity to terminate the contractor. It's in the contract. Does not require litigation. You have the opportunity to go to the surety bondholder and, you know, try to recoup money from them, or force them to force the contractor to comply with the specifications. You do have litigation as an option. You might be able to resolve the problems with a mediation or an arbitration, but it takes a seasoned construction attorney to really look at the facts and to tell you this is your best option, and to tell you what you have to do to document that option. And that is the way that I have handled these kinds of situations in my career. You get that advice before you start taking some action, because then you know you have more confidence that the action you're taking is correct, and you have more confidence that you have the right data to back it up.
Okay. Well, I guess it was something I said that led you to believe that I didn't understand the part about the different legal strategies and the fact that Mr. Cunningham, you know, was an expert construction. What I was listening desperately to hear is for you to tell me why we wouldn't have him analyze the situation on the front end in order to, before going to the attorney, with the problem. I wanted you to explain to me why you would go to the attorney before you find out what the problem is. I was hoping that you was gonna tell me that. But you don't have to tell me. I just wanna know, now I do wanna know from another angle. Can I ask you a couple of questions, sir? Come right up. Yeah, we want everybody to see your nice suit and stuff. Listen, but really, tell me, is this what you're going to do? You're going to look at what's going on, and you're going to see, you're going to point out, draw red circles, highlight where the problem is, and you might even be able to tell
us why they're having these problems and what's making them need these delays based on the plans and based on what you see and based on what's going on. Is that what you explained a few minutes ago that you were going to be able to do?
Correct. And I think one of the important things is that's what I'm going to continue to do. So when we do things, I would think one thing on when you do have bidding, a lot of times you do go to your engineer and bidding services and say, what are your recommendations on this person for future and different things? That's definitely something that should be done, is seek the counsel of your engineer to say, hey, have you guys heard of this contractor? And then once that advice is given, then maybe, you know, it could be given some credence as to then you could say, well, this isn't the lowest qualified, and go to the next. The second part would also be what I'm doing is looking at that. And what we have is we've been doing that and currently doing that. But with such a contractor, it takes a lot more time if we have specifications that are 1,000 pages from a contractor that's used to doing this work, that's read it, that knows how to do the work. It takes a lot less time to manage that type of contractor as opposed to manage a contractor that doesn't know how to do those things. So a lot of what we're doing is putting a lot more effort into documenting everything that's happening, to giving that extra helping hand. It's hours of people in the field to observe what's happening. That's what we're doing. So we have viewed that contractor, and we've spent a lot more time in doing so. This is kind of us continuing to get you to the end with all of the additional concerns that are there.
Okay, because that wasn't mentioned. It does make sense, but that was never mentioned that you were actually doing that now, and that will be some of the information that will be presented to Mr. Cunningham. That was never said. I could understand that clearly. Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay, so did we answer your question?
Did you have a comment?
I did.
Okay.
I want to make sure that we have council's consent to go ahead and retain him to at least consult with staff on the closed construction issue as it unfolds in the next few weeks.
I'm good with that.
Yes.
Do we need an emotion?
I would prefer a motion if we could have it for the record.
Okay, I'd like to make a motion to hire Malcolm Cunningham to work with Ms. Ryan in the utility district on this issue.
Second.
Yes.
Okay. Ms. Attorney, it's 12 hours now. Ms. Anthony.
Board Member Davis Johnson?
Yes.
Board Member Pardo?
Yes.
Board Member Hubbard?
Hubbard.
Board Member Hubbard?
Yes.
Chair Miller Anderson?
Yes.
Unanimous vote.
Okay. Now, we're at the end of the regular agenda now. All right. Comments. First of all, do we have any comment cards? No. Go ahead. You had some? You got a comment?
Yes, ma'am.
Hold on.
I'm sorry.
Chair, before you speak.
No comment.
You need to do that. You've done it. You've spoken twice.
It's okay, Mayor. Mayor, it's fine.
But that's just order. Thank you.
It's okay. So we don't have any comments from the public.
No public comment cards.
Okay, so discussion by the executive director of the utility special district or the city manager.
I have nothing to add tonight. However, Mr. Baudet would like to add something. However, if it pleases the board, if you'd like to go first, and Mr. Baudet could go after.
No, we're
going
to go by what the agenda says. So, okay. I mean, we're not till after this.
I'm sorry that I misunderstood before.
No problem. Go ahead.
Anyway, I have good news for the council. First of all, we've had now over 10 weeks of completely clean and drinkable water throughout the entire city of Riviera Beach.
Wonderful.
And we have tested that water thoroughly. We've kept the health department informed of that. Our staff has worked very, very hard to accomplish this. And I'm very proud of them. In fact, we're going to have a pizza party tomorrow on me because I'm so proud of what they've done. The other thing that I'm proud of is that, and I hope you've had a chance to look at the website that we have a world-class transparency website about our water quality that our citizens in Riviera Beach can go to look at and see what their water quality is. We have posted something that I have never seen before in my entire career, and that is every week we give them the weekly data that we get on their chlorine residual and on their coliform count. Good or bad, but it's been good. They get to go on there and look at their data. So that, and I've never seen that before. You know, usually you see it once a year, once every 6 months, you know, with the water quality report that's required. But now, the website that we have now, we've got it operational. Every week, they get to see the new water quality data. Good. And I think that's a tremendous accomplishment that has been done by our staff, by the IT folks. It's been a joint effort, also very much supported by Ms. Jones. And I'm very, very pleased to tell you that.
Good. That's great news. I want to know, for those residents that may not necessarily have access to the internet, how are we presenting that information? Can we include it possibly in, it may not be every day or as up to date as this information, but could we consider a monthly insert into the water bill that talks about the water quality and providing this very same information?
I think we can do that, yes. We are putting a notice in the bill itself that this information is available on the web, but if people don't have access to the web, I can certainly talk with Mr. Rhodes about what it takes to put an insert into the water bill, and I don't think that would be an impossible task. The other thing is, we have it on Facebook. And I don't know if you've seen Facebook, but if you go to the Riviera Beach Facebook page, we do have that information on there. And we've had some good and bad comments on there, but it's there for people to see.
Okay. Thank you. And I did see it on Facebook. That's how I learned about it. I learned everything about the city on Facebook. Any other comments? Okay, so now statements by the district board. Any comments, Ms. Pardo?
No, the only thing I'll say is, you know, I'm happy that staff finally recognized that there was a problem with that Park Avenue lift station. And that's it. Thank you.
Ms. Davis-Johnson?
No comment.
Ms. Hubbard?
No.
Mr. Mayor?
Yeah, just a brief announcement, digressing a little bit. July 14th, which is Thursday, for those who are viewing, we're having a family and friends day at the City Hall, at the Courtyard Amphitheater, and we have the Motown Magic nine-piece band that will be entertaining, and it's free, and the public is cordially invited. I want to thank Councilwoman Kashama Miller Anderson and Councilwoman Lynn Hubbard for helping to support this event through their community benefits as well, and the Riviera Beach Housing Authority. Thursday, July 14th, 6 p.m. Thank you.
I just had one comment. It makes no difference now. It's at the end of the day. I probably should have brought it up early this morning. I know when we're in City Hall, we have the security there with the metal detectors. Who is swanning people coming in here all day? Okay. Well, we might want to think about that when we do that again. I'm not worried about somebody bothering me, but I'm just saying, I mean, well, if that's the point, why are we doing it over there?
Yeah, we need to.
If we're not
going
to do it
everywhere.
You know, all the time.
Everywhere.
Kind of late, I know. It just came across my mind at the end of the meeting. We've been here 12 hours, but we made it. Did you have something?
I do. I apologize. I meant to actually announce the closed executive session. I need to do it at a public meeting. It doesn't say what type, so I didn't do it at the council meeting. We ran out of time on Wednesday night. So I wanted to go ahead and announce it publicly, and this notice will also be, noticed by the city clerk's office. And I'm going to do what's required under the law, which is to name the case, all those who will be present, and to state the location. So on July 18th at 5:30 p.m., the City Council of the City of Riviera Beach will be going into closed executive session to discuss several cases. The first case will be, and we can discuss them out of order, I'm just naming them as they're listed on the notice. Kathy Ribeiro versus the City of Riviera Beach, And that is a arbitration case number 12-51-829-3. Special counsel will be Jack McLean. And the second case will be Sarita Colbert et al. Versus the City of Riviera Beach. And that is case number 50-2013 CA015041. And special counsel in that case will be Glenn Torsivia and Jonathan O'Connell. The third case to be discussed will be Fane Lozman Renegade Trust 1 and Renegade Trust 2 versus the City of Riviera Beach. Case number 50-2016-CA001527. And special counsel in that case will be Richard Girolam. And the fourth case, and the fourth and final case to be discussed that evening, will be Daniel Taylor individually and as trustee of the Joan B. Taylor Trust versus the City of Riviera Beach, case number 50-2014, CA-010126. And the closed executive session will be held in the City Council chambers. And that's it. Oh, I'm sorry, in addition to those attorneys present, Mayor and Council, of course, myself, and Ms. Jones, and I think we'll have Mr. DeGraffenwright. I'm glad I'll announce it now. I'll make sure I add him. I didn't tell him about it, but he will certainly be able to attend since he will be here with the cases. And I'll also have the Assistant City Attorney, Lana Busby, at that closed executive session as well. And that's it.
Okay. We have a motion to adjourn.
So, second.